Die Rolle mit Kern.
Ja, okay. Ja.
Okay. So, gut aufzunehmen. So, we start a new section, constraint optimization. And first, you had a short summary what we already had in unconstrained optimization. So, we started with gradient descent and then which is zigzagging for narrow valley functions. And then Newton, which is better, but it takes n cube operation when n is dimension of program. And then conjugate gradient and quasi-Newton, they are good for really large problems because they take of an order of n extra computations. And then we told that for moderate size problems up to few thousand dimension, quasi-Newton DFGS is actually the method of choice. And this slide is also LBFGS, actually it's winner, and it's not here. So LBFGS is an important addition to this slide. Limited memory, BFGS. So if you have a problem with hundreds of thousands or millions of variables, and you are able to keep in memory, say, 10 copies of your of size of your vector, this would be first recommendation for nonlinear optimization problems. And if you have quadratic problem, of course, conjugate gradient would be the best choice. And this, I had lectures of this sequential subspace optimization method, but you can watch videos if you are interested in some applications. It's important. So it's a good point to discuss. If you have any questions, any comments, get a complete picture what we learned about unconstrained optimization. So any question, any comment, everything is clear. I am very happy. Or nothing is understandable and then no questions also.
Your
response. Ah, I have two responses on both on opposite side. Yes, yes.
you always make the limitation that you say, okay, up to several thousand dimensions we use quasi-Newton methods.
Yes.
But if I get beyond that, what would be the method of choice then?
Then
steepest descent again?
I personally would start with LBFGS.
Okay.
And then truncated Newton and non-linear conjugate gradient are also sometimes worth to check. They may require less memory, for example. Okay. Yes?
Is there any case we should use one method to get some progress and then move to another one?
One can try. If you have some class of problems, very similar problems, which you need to solve many times, yeah, it's good advice to try many of them and maybe even what you are saying. It's not so typical. It's not so typical, but why not? And also, sorry, one more remark, and if you can move a little bit camera in this direction. One more remark.
You might consider a
trust region. Jessica. Sorry?
You might consider switching on the light, otherwise the video might be a bit dark.
I know, in my experience, it would be almost good. Trust region. say, Newton method. It is also out of scope of our course, but if you have a challenging nonlinear problem, it worth to try. So we use line search methods, mean we compute direction and do one-dimensional optimization in this direction. Alternative approach It's to restrict ourselves, say, to some ball around the current point and minimize, for example, quadratic model over this ball, and then adjust the size of ball for next iterations in order to achieve compromise between accuracy of our model, because the smaller is ball, the more accurate is model, and the progress. So those are also very, very important, so if you are interested. And like I often tell you, the book Nocidal and Wright. Numerical optimization is for me the best reference on this question. The book is on the list of literature. Of the course. And one more thing I mentioned in the lecture, there is a very special method which we don't learn, but it Nadler and me, we don't learn it, but it may be rather recommended when you say, for example, have 5 or 10 variables, or even 20 variables, and even don't have derivatives, it's worth to try it. Okay, more questions, comments? Okay, good. Then we are ready to start the next large part of our course, constraint optimization. So we minimize some objective function of many variables. Usually we talk about smooth functions with constraints. So we minimize our function over area, and area is defined by set of equality or inequality constraints. And the most important picture to give intuition of what happens is this slide. Sorry. If I have, for example, here three inequality constraints, and those are lines where constraints are zero, and inside the area they are negative, so our constraint less or equal to zero inside of this area. And if I draw level lines of my objective function, for example, like here, I see that the lowest level line, so the lowest is here if I would not have constraints, but the lowest level line which has common point with my feasible area, it's here on the picture, and the very important thing that it touches the boundary. Touches the boundary of my feasible set. It says in this example the gradient of objective function and gradient of active constraint, this constraint, are on the same line. Because gradient is orthogonal to the surface. So we have two vectors which are orthogonal to the same surface. To two surfaces, but they touch each other. It means the tangent plane for two surfaces is the same, and that's why this is the central equation of constraint optimization.
One question at that point. Later on, we denote that the gradients of our constraints should be linearly independent.
Yes.
How does this condition look like on such a plot?
Of active constraints.
Yeah, of active constraints.
Are here gradients of active constraints linearly independent?
Yes, because we only have one.
We have only one.
Yeah. What would it
mean? And even, let me continue gradually, and when we have two active constraints, see, plain picture doesn't show you the message, actually. Because what happens if we would have volume, yes? So every constraint is like surface, and they intersect over line. Two surfaces here. It's not point, it's line.
It goes out of the board. No?
Yes, out of the board, yes. And for example, here it's ellipsoids, the surfaces of level sets. And what happens here, the line is tangent to the surface. It means that gradient of my objective function, it's linear combination, it is lying in the plane of those two vectors. So I reduce degrees of freedom. It's important to understand. So I may have here less constraints than dimensionality of my space, and still the, it's not written here, and I will now turn light on, because we want to have okay, because we want to have this case also written. Unfortunately, in the slide. So what we have gradient of objective function star plus gradient of constraints, lambda 1 gradient g, which constraints are active, by the way, than the numbers?
G1 and G2.
G1 of x star plus lambda 2 gradient g2 star is 0. So the objective function gradient lies in the plane of those two gradients, despite that you may have here three-dimensional. And in general, I want just to have it on the whiteboard. We will define Lagrangian of x lambda, which is f of x plus some lambda I gi of x. And what we have here, we have the gradient with respect to x of Lagrangian at the point x star. At some point, sometimes we call those vector also lambda star. It's optimal. Lambda star is zero. So those are very, very root relationships which we use again and again in constraint optimization. So from this is one way, one simple way to get notion of Lagrangian. Get notion of Lagrangian and optimality to have optimality condition. Any question, any comment at this point? This is new for you. You kind of learned it, but I'm afraid not in this way, in some other ways. Yes, the Lagrange multiplier. It usually is given in some formal, more formal, without geometry. Okay. Yes. Any comment? Okay. We will continue. And then we summarize what we had until now. I will play a little bit with light. I don't know. Find good compromise between screen. Oops. Light. No. Okay. this line of legs? Ah, they all go together? Nothing to do. Okay, so now we summarize. So we already have this central relation, the gradient of Lagrangian is zero. So it's Karosh, Kuhn, Tucker, first order, necessary optimality condition. Summary of what we already know. So gradient of Lagrangian is zero. Of course, point should be feasible, so constraints should be satisfied. And like we saw in from the picture, the coefficients of those constraint gradients are non-negative for inequality constraints. And if we want to write everything in this form, not saying about that we have active constraints or non-active, we just put general sum, but we say that multipliers of non-active constraints we put to zero. And this is what is written here. And if we summarize these three things, we give this condition, which has special role, and it's called complementarity slackness. How do we see it in a simple way? If a constraint is active, so it is zero at solution, so this term will be zero. And if constraint is non-active, we say lambda is zero. And all of them are of the same sign. They are or negative or zero, every term. So that's why this together with this is like those three, yes? And those two maybe are equivalent. Okay. And I move forward. And now we go to the first method how to solve the constraint optimization problem. Each, if what we have in our possession, the methods for unconstrained optimization. So we built a penalty function for violation of constraint, and including aggregate our objective function, and minimize all together and put build set of penalty functions which are more and more tight locked on our feasible set. And this is the basic way to solve. Okay, so we have this kind of problem, and it will be convenient for us to write it equivalent way, so we minimize our objective function. Subject to X belongs to feasible set, and here is definition of feasible set. So these two writings are the same. And what we also will do, we will be built a penalty function, it's like smooth penalty, with soft penalty, yes? We only slightly penalize violation of constraint. Because constraint should be negative, violations of all positive numbers we penalize, but we built also parametric family of penalty functions in the way when parameter p become larger and larger, penalty become more and more close to corner, to so-called ideal penalty. Ideal penalty means it goes to infinity when x is infeasible, but it doesn't influence anything, it is zero inside the feasible area. And here you have two examples. Function. This quadratic logarithmic example desired from computation. And then we build the penalty aggregate. Some of our objective function plus penalty of constraints. And of course, when the penalty parameter goes to infinity, we have ideal penalty aggregate, which is goes to infinity when we are outside of feasible set, but it is our objective inside. So if we would be able to minimize it, we immediately get solution of our problem. But technically, it is difficult to do it with numerical unconstrained optimization because we don't like corners. So in practice, we will do it sequentially. We will just start with some moderate value of penalty parameter, minimize it, it's Newton, quasi-Newton method, and so on, and increase penalty by some factor, by a reasonable factor, 2 or 10, for example, and start new unconstrained optimization from the point we already achieved. This is rather practical. Actually, this is one of the most practical methods for unconstrained, for constraints, sorry, for constraint optimization. Any question at this point?
What?
Yes.
Okay,
two. Yes, yes. Yes. The question is why we go so gradually, why we increase only by moderate factor. If you will increase it, for example, 100 times, you may discover that you will require a lot of very many Newton or quasi-Newton steps to get back to the area of reasonably accurate. So this is a kind of art, and in concrete, or people build universal solvers, and then they restrict themselves by some very moderate alpha. Or again, if you have family of problems which you want to solve, you play a little bit with this parameter and find out what is good one, what is the good one. But this is like from practical experience. Okay, was one more question?
It was more or less what I wanted to ask.
Ah, okay, good. This is not related to our stuff. Okay. And then we say that we can touch again the question of Lagrange multipliers with penalty, because interestingly, unconstrained optimality condition for penalty aggregate, it's very close to our condition of zero of gradient of Lagrange, or Karosh-Kontaker condition. Gradient of objective plus linear combination of gradients of constraints should be zero. And how do we get to this? We look on our penalty aggregate very carefully, and we are educated now. We are able to write down its gradient, which is written here. It's gradient of objective plus derivatives of this one-dimensional function, phi p, penalty function, multiplied by gradients of constraints. So you already see that you have very similar structure. If I denote this as lambda I in with index p, this expression is very close to the expression like we had the gradient of Lagrange, of usual Lagrange. And we say that, Okay, we already told as parameter p goes to infinity, minimizer of penalty aggregate goes to our actual solution. And we have the same relation. We have the gradient of objective function plus weighted sum of gradients of constraints is zero at the solution point. And here comes into play requirement that we want the gradient of active constraints to be linearly independent. If they are linearly independent, then there is a unique set of coefficients lambda which will satisfy this equality. And that's all. This is a very deep connection between penalty function method and Lagrange multipliers. I will not get into details how I do it in matrix form. There is one more comment. Do I have it on my slide or maybe not? Okay, we have this picture on the top. How penalty function looks, yes? So if I have non-active constraints and I say that my lambda they are derivatives, yes? Let me jump one slide before. My lambda are derivatives of my penalty function. So if my constraint is non-active, then I am inside of feasible area, and as I increase my penalty parameter, the penalty inside of feasible area becomes zero, so it becomes more and more flat. So its derivative goes to zero. So this term will become zero for active constraints. For non-active constraints. And for active constraints, it will be some number, and by the way, it will be non-negative number. It will be positive number. Positive or close to zero. It will be non-negative. So we get again this element of Karush-Kontakter condition that Lagrange multipliers of inequality constraints should be non-negative. Lambda greater or equal to zero. We reiterated everything once again. Let's stop a little bit on this point. Any question, any comment at this point? Okay. And then two small additional pieces. What can we do when we have equality constraint? So we want our constraint to be as close as possible to zero. So we penalize its violation to negative and to positive direction. For example, we can do quadratic function as our penalty. Introduce parameter p, just multiply this quadratic function with some large number. So when this number will become larger and larger, the penalty will become stronger and stronger, even for a tiny violation from zero. And if we say that, just a second. If you say that Lagrange multipliers are actually derivatives of penalty function, we see that for equality constraint, penalty function may have a negative and positive derivative. So there is no restriction on sign of Lagrange multipliers for equality constraints.
Why do you need a penalty function for an equality constraint? If you use just a regular Lagrangian, you can have any equality constant you want.
To write down Lagrangian and even optimality condition that gradient of Lagrangian is zero, it is not yet giving us way to solve general optimization problem. Sometimes it's enough to get analytical solution. But in general, it doesn't provide us with numerical, with clear numerical methods how to get to this point where gradient of Lagrangian is zero. You can say that actually what is written here, it's set of nonlinear equations, yes? Because gradient of Lagrangian is a vector, which is a function of two vectors, and you can run some methods for solving system of nonlinear equations. Become complicated, especially with inequality concept, because you need to find this solution over restrictions that lambda
right.
Non-negative. For equality constraints, it's like easier, and really sometimes people do it, but still solve system of nonlinear equation itself, it's maybe more challenging problem than minimize functions. So sometimes one can prefer to minimize penalty aggregate over solving the system of equation, but it depends on your concrete case. Sometimes yes, one can go Newton or some other methods.
But why won't I just try to minimize the upper expression, the middle one? Just try to minimize
this one. We don't.
If I minimize.
Okay, you're asking. Why not to minimize Lagrangian in X? First of all, we don't know optimal. If I would know optimal Lagrange multipliers, we will learn that there is a augmented Lagrangian, which is next time. And really, by one minimization in X, we get to solution. But first of all, you don't have this optimal Lagrange multipliers.
I don't need it.
In advance.
Let's just say I take the vector x and I add it. I add two parameters to it, lambda 1 and lambda 2, and I treat it as one vector. I do like gradient descent and I just ignore the bottom two variables.
You're asking very good questions, thank you very much. And the answer is that interestingly, this optimality condition, it's not condition for minimum. We will learn in one lecture after that this is so-called saddle point. This is minimum over x and maximum over lambda. So standard optimization, standard minimization methods will not get us to this point. So the